submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now that does not sound so bad. But if you continue on in the book of Ephesians chapter 5, you run into verses like this. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands. Submission is a concept that many people recoil against. But this passage in Ephesians 5 is filled with all kinds of things that are very difficult for us to do. For instance, husbands, you might have noticed this, and maybe you haven't. If you're considering becoming a husband someday, you might want to reconsider, because look at what it says for you to do. Love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Now remember what Jesus did for us, what that means, gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her for the washing with water through the word to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. Now, let's just bring that into the marriage. That's what Christ did for the church. So what do you think that ought to look like, guys, when it says that we're supposed to love our wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her? What's that look like? What does it look like? It at least looks like a lot of effort. It looks like they should be very important. But frankly, I won't ask, ladies, please don't respond out loud. Do you feel like you're that important? If we were to take a quiz and our wives were to take it on our behalf, gentlemen, how would we be doing? We really like the wives submit to your husband's part. But we don't necessarily want to have to line up under what that means for us to give ourselves. So we're supposed to submit. We're supposed to give ourselves up. Who can do these things? Who would do these things? Is God telling us to do something that he knows there's no way in the world we would want to do them or could even have the ability to do? No. What he's doing is he's telling us what his standards are and that there's no way in the world that we can do them in and of ourselves in our own strength. As much as we want to, we can't do them. But God does not ever call us to do something that he doesn't also equip us to do if we will simply look to him and not to ourselves. He points out our inability not to make us feel bad, but to make us fall on our knees and say, God, I can't do this. I have to rely on you. Last week we saw that God's secret to a great marriage, frankly, to having any kind of great relationship, is sacrifice. And we saw last week that mutual sacrifice will bring us to the place where we really want to be, mutual fulfillment. But as human beings, we start at this fulfillment part and we say, if I'm going to have a happy marriage, I'm going to have to be fulfilled. So I'm going to look for someone who's going to fulfill me. And as soon as they don't fulfill me anymore, then I'm going to look for somebody else. And that's when we short-circuit what God is wanting to do in each and every one of our lives. Because the secret to a great marriage, the secret to any great relationship, is mutual sacrifice, which will always lead to mutual fulfillment. But there's not a person in this room that can do that on their own. There's not one. We can fake it for a while. But this is not one of those fake it till you make it sort of things. You can't do it. Because you're human. Just like me. And every other person in this world. So today, we are going to learn what God's power source is to enable us to do what he's calling us to do. Because see, God does not call the qualified. He qualifies the called. And so he has a power source for you and for me. If we will plug into it, it will enable us to do the things he's calling us to do. Ladies, it will enable you to submit. Husbands, it will enable you to give yourselves. Couples, individuals, it will enable all of us to submit to one another. Because submission is not just a feminine word. Submission is something that every single one of us needs to do. You want to know how I know that? Well, first of all, the verse that we're going to read in just a minute says it. But second of all, the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, God the Son submitted to his Father. The Holy Spirit submitted to Jesus. But as they both did that, it didn't diminish who they were. They were completely God. And yet, they functioned in a different role, and that's what submission is all about. We're not going to get into that too much depth today. However, I just want to lay that foundation that submission, the S word, is not a bad thing. The way we have abused it and abused the people that are supposed to be submitted to us, that's a sin. That's a wrong that we've foisted on each other. But that's not what we're talking about. Because when we understand the power source that we can plug into, that God will enable us then to submit to one another and will enable us to give just as Christ gave himself for the church. You want to turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5. We'll start in verse 15. It's on page 816 in the Pew Bible in front of you. If you don't happen to have a Bible, please take one of those and use it today. And if you don't own a Bible, take it as our gift. I want to read this passage together. It'll be up on the screen. You can read it out of the Bible in the pew there, but I want to read it out loud together, if you would. Be very careful then how you live. Read it out loud with me. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. This passage is an introduction to the rest of the chapter. We don't see this in the English language, but in the original, it is one long sentence. So when we come down to that last phrase, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ, the only way we can do that is if we do the first part. If we are under the control of the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit is working in each and every one of our lives. Now, in this passage, he lays out two different ways that we can choose to live life. He says that you can be unwise or wise, you can waste your days, or you can make the most of every opportunity. He says you can choose to be foolish or you can choose to have understanding. Then to put them all together, the unwise, wasteful, and foolish life gets inebriated on all the things that the world has to offer. In other words, we focus on all the things that the world has to offer and we miss what God has for us. Because we say, I want fulfillment, and I'm not going to go God's way for that. I'm going to go after fulfillment. This whole self-sacrifice thing, I'm not for that. And we can make that choice. But I think Dr. Phil's words will ring in our ears at some point in our lives if we do. How's that working for you? Because God's way is always best. Even if we don't understand it. Even if we have never heard it before, as we hear God's way and we hear God's word, he says, this is my way. Walk in this. He doesn't do it because he's an ogre or he's a control freak. He does it because he wants us to have the best life possible. And he knows that the only way that will be possible is if we follow him. So he says, the wise person of understanding, who makes the most of every opportunity, lives his or her life under the control of the Spirit by submitting to the Holy Spirit's influence in our lives. So only if we submit to the control of the Holy Spirit will we as husbands or wives be able to fulfill the things God's called us to as couples. Now, I don't want to leave anyone out here. If you're single, maybe you're widowed, maybe you're divorced, maybe you've never been married as a single person, maybe you are looking forward to it, maybe you're engaged. This principle is true with every single one of us. The only way we will be able to sacrifice the way God wants us to is if we will submit ourselves to the Holy Spirit. Because sacrifice is a submission to the will of God. And so, willingly submitting ourselves to the control of the Holy Spirit is the way that we will be able to do the things that God has called us to do. His influence in your heart, your mind, and your will give you everything you need to fulfill all that he's called you to do. One of the biggest problems in the church, maybe it's fair to say one of the biggest problems in our church, because I know it's the biggest problem in my life, is when I see something wrong in my mind, my desires, my will, and it contrasts with the Bible, then I'm likely to think that there's something wrong with the Bible and not me. I'm wired that way. Maybe you can relate to that. But could it be that the core of our problem is that when there's something in my head, my heart, and my mind that disagrees with the Bible, that maybe, just maybe, there's something wrong with me? I'm the one who's not getting it yet. I'm the one who doesn't understand and doesn't maybe want to understand what God is trying to say to me. I think it's time, high time, in our church, in our lives, in our country, culture, the world, but let's just say here, for us to stop doubting the Word of God and start believing the Word of God, even when our minds and our hearts disagree with it. When we do that, then God will work in our lives. Until God has a proper place in my life, I will remain unhappy, discontented. I'll feel let down by my job, by my friends, by my spouse, because they never appreciated me enough, they never recognized me enough, they never gave me enough credit. God never calls us to do anything that he does not equip us for. He knows that we are ill-equipped to be the husbands that we're supposed to be, to be the wives that we're supposed to be the friends that we're supposed to be the sons, the daughters, the dads, the moms. We can't do it in and of ourselves. Now, not only does he provide us the motivation, he will get us to the fulfillment where we got to start with self-sacrifice, but then he also gives us the power. He empowers us to do what he calls us to do. We've looked at verse 18 just shortly. Don't be drunk with wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. There's something happening in that passage that I frankly hadn't noticed before. In verse 18, you could translate that, be continually being filled with the Spirit. Now, it's an imperative verb. That means it's a command. So that the reason it's translated be filled is because it's a command. But the sense of it, if we're not careful, we'll miss it. Because what we're supposed to be doing is be continually being filled with the Spirit. It's something that's got to continue to happen. But sorry for the English language lesson, but it applies to Greek. The verb is in the passive mood, which means that the action that's being taken is something that's done to the object, to you and me. We're being told, be filled with the Spirit. What the, and it's a command, right? I'm being told, be filled with the Spirit. So it's not an option. God says to me, you got to do this. He's going to hold me responsible. However, I can't do it. It's something that has to be done from outside of me to me. I have to yield myself to God to not just, we like to use this word, invite God to do this. I have to surrender. Be continually being filled. So what God is saying to me in this verse is, Len, continually, every day, every step, every thought, every action, continue to yield to me. And I will empower you to do what only I can empower you to do. So, the Holy Spirit is the agent of the filling. He's the one who's in control. It should not be me. So Paul could say in another passage, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. It's not me who lives, but Christ who lives in me. And he's saying, hey, it's not me. And when he talks about how God is working in him, he says, it's not me, it's the grace of God that's working in me. What's that mean? He's understood that he's yielding to him. Every step, every action, every thought, everything. It's about me and you surrendering and saying, Spirit of God, have full control of my life. In everything I do and in everything I say, the Holy Spirit is the one who's in control. So Galatians 5:16 says, so I say, live by the Spirit. When he's in control, you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. But what does it look like to be filled with the Holy Spirit? He's the agent. He's the one who's in control. But what's the content? What's he pouring into me? God's word is what he fills us with. So here's a parallel passage to the one we're looking at in Ephesians 5. This is in Colossians 3. We read, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. Now, notice the parallel between these two passages. This is Ephesians 5, the passage we already read. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And then, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Every disciple, every follower of Jesus is commanded to submit ourselves to the control of the Holy Spirit. We are each to be being continually filled with the Spirit. This is not an elder role. This is not for the pastor alone. This is not for the Sunday school teachers or the life class facilitators. It's not for your life group facilitators. It's for you. And it is for me. And if we will continually be yielding to the Holy Spirit, then he will work in us. And the question I think we have to ask is, what's the evidence that someone's filled? How will I know it? Some of us are a little bit afraid of this. We're afraid that if we ask and we yield to be filled with the Holy Spirit, that we're going to speak in tongues. Or that somebody's going to walk up to us and whack us in the forehead to heal us. Or we're going to have some funky thing happen. You know what? God can do anything. And I'm not discussing those issues right now. However, I can tell you that there is clear evidence of what it looks like to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And it isn't necessarily any of that. any of those things that we are a bit uncomfortable with. In the book of Acts, the church came upon a major issue. And the apostles said, you know, we don't want to leave doing what we're doing. Instead, here's what we want you to do, church. This is Acts chapter 6, and just part of verse 3. Brothers, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom. Okay? They're known to be full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom. So in other words, the other believers around them can recognize that the Spirit of God is in them. And to be full means to be controlled, means to be evident. So in verse 6, they chose these 7 guys, and they said, we recognize these to be full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. So the apostles required them to be full of the Holy Spirit, and there had to be some objective evidences that the Holy Spirit was in control of them. So how did they know that they were full of the Holy Spirit? How can you and I know when someone is full of the Holy Spirit? There's at least 2 major categories. First of all, you can know when someone's under the control of the Holy Spirit through their character. Through their character. By who they are when you're with them. Not necessarily behavior, although character shows itself in behavior. But if you look at someone and they evidence these things, they're full of the Holy Spirit. This is the list from Galatians 5, 22 and 23. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, I grew up in a church where the way we tried to do this was, 1 week I was supposed to grit it out and I was supposed to make myself be peaceful. And then the next week I was supposed to make myself be joyful. And by the time I got to patience, I was not joyful anymore. Because this is not something I can do in myself. You can't either. This only happens because you are yielded to the Spirit of God. Because the Spirit of God has control in your life. He's pouring the content of the Word of God into your life. That's when these things will happen. Because that's what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. So, obvious in your character. When the Spirit is in control of somebody, when somebody's under the influence of the Holy Spirit, it'll be true in their care, obvious in their character, but it will also be obvious in their behavior. Now, in our passage in Ephesians 5, he lays out 4 evidences in somebody's behavior. Now, these first couple may seem a little bit strange. First one, you will have a song on your lips. You'll have a song on your lips. It says, speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Does that mean that I have to have a great singing voice? No. Yes. No. It just means that you are so overflowing with God's truth. And with who God is in your life, you can't help but sing about it. And you might do it in the quiet because you're self-conscious. You might do it away from everybody because you're self-conscious. But this is one of the evidences that Paul tells us. You'll have a song in your lips. You'll also have a song in your heart. It says, sing and make music in your heart to the Lord. Ever wake up in the morning with a praise song in your mind? Maybe it's because you're yielding yourself a little bit more to the Holy Spirit. As we are preparing ourselves to go to Japan and help grow relationships with Japanese people who don't know Jesus and be part of the gospel choir, we are reviewing and going over these gospel songs. Please pray for us. Black gospel music is phenomenal. But it's not how I normally sing. But the truth in these things is so incredible. You go throughout the day and you meditate on, you ruminate over the truth that's here. And it'll change your life. I think that's why it says in the first one, the song in your lips, speak to one another with psalms and spiritual songs. The content is important. Think about the words. When we do the music we do here, you'll notice sometimes if you're on the younger side, you'll be like, oh man, they're playing the organ today. Or you're on the older side, oh man, they're playing the drums today. We don't care about that. We don't care. Here's why. We want to communicate God's truth. And we want to include as many people as we can, generationally. And so we will use whatever song, whatever vehicle that we can to lift Jesus up. Were you not lifted up this morning in those first three songs? I mean, I felt it in me. And I mean, I'll be honest, I prefer the drums over the organ. But it's all opportunity to worship God. And we come together as an intergenerational representation of the body of Christ. Because one day we will stand before God. Every tribe, every tongue, every nation, everyone. And we will worship God. And I'm sure there'll be an organ there. And I'm sure there'll be four or five sets of drums there. Let's don't allow that sort of thing to keep us from being together and worshiping God. A disciple is also one who is clearly under the Spirit's influence when they are a grateful person. He says, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything. Paul wrote these words when he was in prison. Now, unless he's the biggest hypocrite ever, he couldn't write those words without being grateful. Now, I don't think Paul was saying, thank you for the beating I took. He might have said, thank you for the chains. Because we know that while he was chained, he had a Roman guard with him too. And when those guys walked into the room, they'd be like, oh no, not him again. And Paul would be like, yes. I get to tell them about Jesus. And so many guards came to know Jesus, and later on in one of the epistles, he talks about all the believers that were in Caesar's household. You know how they got to be believers? Because Paul was on the inside, sharing Jesus with them. He was grateful even then. Are we grateful for the tough times that come into our lives? I'm not saying we need to be masochists, but I am saying that nothing comes into our hands that hasn't first passed through the hands of our loving Father. And we can be grateful that He's in control. And that maybe He's going to bring someone into your life that you will meet because you're in that difficult time that you'd never meet any other way. And what happens if you're angry at God, if you're sour about Him, if you're mean-spirited, if you're spiteful? You'll turn them away from God instead of to God. But if we are yielding to Him and saying, have your way with me today, God, I'm yielding to you, that is a completely different outcome. A completely different one. And the fourth observable evidence that the Spirit is calling the shots in the disciples' life is that they submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now, before I move on to the implications of what it means to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ, I want to highlight an important qualifier. Notice the last part of the verse. It says, our mutual submission is to be done out of reverence for Christ. We submit because we revere, we honor, we love Jesus. That is why we submit. When I submit to someone else, I'm doing it out of my submission for Jesus, not out of my submission to them. Because I think we're headed for complete and utter destruction when our submission is simply to our spouse, because that submission always comes with strings attached. Probably on both sides. But if our submission begins with Jesus, then He takes that and changes it. The outline for the series we're doing is I've taken from this book by Tim and Kathy Keller, The Meaning of Marriage. And I want to share with you a little bit of a lengthy story that they tell of someone that I think really helps you and me connect with what Paul's saying here. I once knew a woman in her late 30s who had never married. Her family and her part of the country believed that there was something radically wrong with a woman who was of that age and was still single. She wrestled greatly with shame and a feeling that she had somehow failed as a woman. Because of this, she also had tremendous unresolved anger against a man who she had dated for many years, but who had been unwilling to marry her. Finally, she went to a counselor. The therapist told her that she had taken to heart her family's approach to personal value, namely, that a woman had to have a husband and children if she was to be of any worth. She was bitter against this man because he had come between her and the things she felt that she had to have for her life to have any significance. The counselor then proposed that she throw off such unenlightened view and devote herself to a career. If you come to see yourself as a good, accomplished person, then you will see that you don't need a man or anyone else to give you a sense of worth. So she began to shed her family and culture's view of women and to pursue a career. She began to feel better. But she discovered that it didn't enable her to get over her resentment toward her longtime ex-boyfriend. And about this time, she was going to a church where she was hearing the gospel clearly for the first time. She heard that the gospel was not what she had thought, that we amass a good record, give it to God, and he saves us. Instead, the gospel is that Jesus Christ has amassed a perfect record, and when we believe in him, he gives it to us. He lived that life. He lived the life that we should have lived and died the death that we should have died in our place, so that when we believe, our sins are pardoned and we are counted righteous in his sight. Then we are completely accepted and loved by the only one in the universe whose opinion really counts. She began to realize that the well-meaning counselor was only half right. Indeed, it was wrong for her to seek her self-worth through male affection. That was a trap. It made her self-regard contingent on what men thought of her. But now, she was being asked to look to her career and accomplishments as a way to feel good about herself. That meant that her self-image would be dependent on her success as achieving economic independence. So, she said, why should I leave the ranks of the many women who make family their whole life to join the ranks of many men who make careers their whole lives? Would I not be as devastated then by career setbacks as I've been by romantic ones? No. I will rest in the righteousness of Christ and learn to rejoice in it. Then I will look at males or career and say, what makes me beautiful to God is Jesus, not those things. And you can only do that if, like her, you yield yourself to the Word of God and allow the Holy Spirit to pour it into you so that it changes how you think. It changes what you look to fulfill you. It changes what you look to bring about that sense of self-worth, because that's what it looks like to be filled with the Spirit. When we let the Spirit of God apply the Word of God to our lives, with every choice, every decision, every opportunity, every relationship, every thought and action, then he will mold us into his image and make us more like Jesus. We have never been more in need of drawing our thoughts from the Scriptures rather than pushing our thoughts onto the Scriptures or around them. Plug into God's power source, his Word. Allow him to help you understand it, and he will change your life. Then you'll gladly fulfill the role that he called you to. You'll gladly be the woman that he wants you to be and the man that he wants you to be. Whether you're married or not, just as these elements, the elements of community, remind us of the sacrifice that Christ made for us, his willing offering of himself to us. So the Word of God reminds us, because God went to all the effort to preserve it over thousands of years for us, it reminds us that God has a work that he's continuing to do in us as a result of that sacrifice. And he wants to change us and empower us so that we can sacrifice for one another following his example. William Blake captures our dilemma well in his poem, The Clod and the Pebble. And we can have, he represents two choices here in this. The first choice, we can choose to yield to the Spirit's control. Listen to these words. Love seeketh not itself to please, nor for itself hath any care, but for another gives its ease and builds a heaven in hell's despair. Or we can follow self. Love seeketh only self to please, to bind another to its delight, joys in another loss of ease, and build a hell in heaven's despite. The power that God gives us for marriage or for strong relationships is found in surrendering to the Spirit's control and letting him build a heaven in hell's despair. So, I have a passage that you might consider doing this with, yielding to the Spirit's control. It comes from Philippians chapter 2. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. You want to write that down because it's not anywhere in your notes or anything. And what I want to challenge you to do is I want you to meditate on it, to think about it, to mull it over, just read it, and ask, what does this say? List off all the different things that you notice in the passage. And then ask the Holy Spirit to make it clear. We've asked, what does it say? Then we're going to ask, what does it mean? And then ask the Holy Spirit to point out something in your life, some way that you could apply it. That's the simplicity of it. We come to him, we ask him what it says, we ask him what it means, and we ask him how it applies. And as we do that, and he pours his word into you, he will change you. You will be completely and radically surrendered more and more to him. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for your word, and thank you for the opportunity you give us to be different people because your Spirit works in us. Father, I pray that you would help us to yield and to follow after you in the things that you prompt us to do. May we surrender to your Spirit and allow you to make us the men and women we are.